this concern, but I'm gonna tell you, I didn't have much assurance on getting back home one day when we was on vacation. And I'm gonna tell y'all about that story. It all started. First of all, let me tell you this. Let me give you, I don't know if y'all write in your Bibles or not, but if you do write in your Bibles, you might want to write this right here. Do not follow Siri in the mountains. Okay? Because she will get you messed up. Because I'm going to tell you what happened. We, one day on vacation, I put in more miles on this vacation than a cross-country trucker taking my family everywhere. And they had a great time. And meanwhile, I was just driving continually, like 2,000 miles. I just changed the oil in my truck. Now it's due again for an oil change. So one of our excursions, we went up to Roanoke and had a good day up there eating my favorite restaurant, 611 Steakhouse. If y'all ain't never tried it, better try it before you die, because it's good. So we come back, and they said, well, let's just take the parkway and go back that way, which sounded like a good idea to me. And so we got on the parkway, and it's like up one mountain, down the next, and then all it's beautiful, all these overviews, but let me tell you one thing about the Blue Ridge Parkway. They do not have bathrooms. And the bathrooms they do have are not open this time of year. So, that's one thing to keep in mind. And so anyway, after Siri said it only take an hour to get from Roanoke back to where we were going. So like 2 hours later, we were like, we need to find a shortcut. We got to get off the parkway and get back on a real road. And so Christy, my navigator, she's like, no problem. I got it right here. So I just pulled it up. All you got to do is mile marker is such and such. Take a left. I was like, well, I'm ready. I'm ready to get on a good road. So there it is. Take a left. So we took a left and immediately the road went like this. That should have been a sign right there. Because I'm sitting, the truck went down like this. And right before we got off, it's at elevation 4,000 feet. So we were 4,000 foot in the air. And then I got on this road, and it was a state road now, because it had a number. But state road is a subjective term. What you want to call a state road. This one did have some form of tar and gravel, and it was at least this wide. So I guess in Floyd County, that qualifies as a state road. And I'll tell you another thing about Floyd County. Evidently, they don't have a large tax base because they can't afford guardrails. And so when you're on a road this wide, 4,000 feet in the air, and you look over the edge and you see the bottom. But what I want to tell you, on that road, there were two things that were consistent the whole time. Two things. Number one, there was a stream. At first, you could barely make it out down there in the bottom. And that road followed that stream. And then there was a mountain in the distance with this certain shape. And that rock at the top. You could always see it. And we were up and down, around, up and down. But you could always see that rock. And so here we go. We're going down, and so in case, has anybody got drama in their lives? Anybody got any drama in their lives? I found out how to take all your drama away. Christy's got these little pills they call drama mine. Christy told me when you take one of those pills, all your drama just And so everybody in my truck lost their drama because they're all popping in little drama mine pills. Show them, Christy, you got to. If you ever have drama in your life, you take one of those pills and the drama just goes. And so anyway, we were going, because it makes you a little nervous when you can see down 4,000 feet and the road's this wide. And so we're like, please, Lord, meet us at start point. Please, Lord, Jesus, get us to the end. We get all the way down the mountain. Thank you, Jesus. We made it down the mountain. Then we go back up again. Go back up another mountain, so it was like 2 hours on this road, and finally we were getting down next to where we could actually see the water, and that made it even more scary, because if you went in your car then, you would drown probably before the fall would kill you, so, and then Christy would have to say, Lord, I hope we don't meet another car on this road, and then, there you go, another car, and so here I am looking down the cliff, and I just stopped, and I'm not moving. I don't care. I'll put it in park. Whatever you want to do, you can do. I'm staying over here. And so finally they made their way around me. About, it's like that close to get by. We finally kept going. We made it to the end. We got to the end of the road. And I was like, well, we were just hallelujah, praise God, rejoicing. And Lucas said, Daddy, what's that sign mean right there? And I said, what do you mean? He said, back the road, we come off of, look at that. So we turned around and there was a sign up there. It said, do not follow GPS down this road. Why didn't they put it at the other end? They didn't put it at the end I come from. But as I said, the thing that got me there, obviously the roads and the mountains all followed the streams. Because everywhere we went, if there was a road, it was right beside a stream. But on that one particular road, we always had that rock in sight. And, you know, Bible says Jesus Christ is our spiritual rock. He's our spiritual. You ever had anybody been through a bad time in their life? You know, you have somebody saying, I'm going through a bad time in my life right now. And immediately, what's the first thing that somebody tells you? Oh, bless your heart. God will never put more on you than you can handle. And you know, that's good human advice, but it's not biblical. Because that's not what the Bible says about that. Did you know that? If you got your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And we're going. I think now I might be wrong on that because now I got my Bible all turned here. Yes, I was on the right page, wrong chapter. The 10:13 says. So this is the proper thing. It says there hath no temptation. 1 Corinthians 10:13. There is no temptation taking upon you. And this word temptation, there's no trial. It doesn't mean he's going to tempt you. There's no trial. There's no obstacle that's come upon you but that which is common to man. And it goes on to say, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tried above that which you are able to handle. And that's where they get it from. God will never put more on you than you can handle. But they miss this next part. And if you got that in the Bible, you should underline this. It says, unless with the temptation, with the trial, he also make a way to escape that you may bear. So it don't necessarily say he won't put more on you than you can handle. But it says if he does, he will show you a way out. And so if you turn back here, back to chapter 10, verse 4. This is what made me think about that rock. When I was going down that road, no matter where I turned, no matter how up, how down, left or right, I always saw that rock in sight. It says that, and they did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. So that rock followed them. But what is he talking about here? You see, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, what he's really talking about is people in exodus. The people that were in the wilderness, back during the wilderness wanderings. And so, if we go to Exodus chapter 17, it'll be the last time you have to turn in the Bible today, I promise you. Exodus chapter 17 talks about that spiritual rock that is Jesus Christ. And I believe that's who guided me through that mountain, was that spiritual rock of Jesus Christ. Exodus chapter 17 says, and all of the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin after their journeys according to the commandment of the Lord and pitched in Rephidim. And there was no water for the people to drink. Wherefore the people did chide, or they grumbled with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said to them, why do y'all grumble with me? Why for do you try the Lord? And the people were thirsty, and they griped and mumbled against Moses and said, why is it that you brought us out of Egypt to kill us in the desert by this thirst? Verse 4 is the turning point of this passage. And Moses cried unto the Lord, saying, what shall I do unto this people they be almost ready to stone. Verse 5, and the Lord said unto Moses, go on before the people, and take thee with the elders of Israel, and thy rod, wherewith thou smotest the river. This is the rod where he smote, he hit the river when they were in Egypt, and it turned to blood, and Pharaoh finally let them go. That same stick, he said, take that stick and hit the rock, and water shall come out of it that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders, and he called the name of that place Massah and Meribah, because the children of Israel, they tempted the Lord and said, is the Lord among us or not? I want to talk about that spiritual rock today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we come to you in the precious name of Jesus, Lord, and I thank you for that spiritual rock, Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that right now you would open up our hearts and minds to receive your message. Lord, fill our hearts with that Holy Ghost power. Open our ears and our minds and our hearts to receive the message, Lord, and may the message be yours and not mine. You just control my tongue and everything that comes out of it, Lord, and let my words be your words. You just use me to accomplish your will, Lord. I just pray that you would touch hearts and change lives here today. In Jesus' name, amen. Yes, we see that. The people are at a bad place in their lives. And how many times have people told you, they said, you know what, I'm in a bad place in my life right now. I've had people tell me, I'm just in a bad place in my life. Well, see, these people were really in a bad place in their life. Where were they? Well, the Bible says they were in the wilderness of sin. Oh my gosh, what a place for a child of God to be. The wilderness of sin. That tells me that these children of God have wandered away. They went off the path of God and they wound up in the wilderness where they're dry and withering and in need of God. They've lost sight of God. They've lost sight of their spiritual life. And I'm telling you, if that's you, you're in a bad place. But the good news is you ain't got to stay there. You ain't got to stay there. They were in a dry place. They were in a brutal place, in a desert place. But let me tell you something else. They were in God's place. What? Yeah. Chapter 17, verse 1 says, and they were in the wilderness of sin after their journeys. But then if you underline stuff in your Bible, underline the words, according to the commandment of the Lord. They were there because the Lord put them. You know, the Lord puts his people to the test. And this word for trial here, the word for tempted is not like God is going to tempt you to do something, because the Bible says God is no tempter of men. He doesn't tempt you to do stuff, but he does test you. This word temptation here in the Bible is a word for like they used to test their armor. You know, if they were going out in battle, they had to test their armor. They had to test it to see if it was going to withstand a dart or a bow or whatever. And if the armor won't no good, then they couldn't use it. Well, you know, God's people are the same way. He tests us sometimes, don't he? He tests us to see if we're really going to be usable to him or not. And so he had these Israelites out here, and he was testing them, and he was trying them. And it was getting to them, wasn't it? Because it gets to us. Why? Why does God's testing get to us? Well, it's because of our human nature, because of this flesh right here. What does it make us do? We see the first thing they did, they were hot and tired and they were thirsty. And that human nature got the best of them. And what happened? Well, they said they started grumbling. They started griping. And finally, they asked, is the Lord with us or not? Is the Lord really here? Is it the Lord's will that I be here? And that sounds like a modern-day Christian right there. Is the Lord really with me? We pray to God, and he doesn't answer our prayers immediately. And we say, well, God don't even love me. God ain't worried about me. He ain't even answering my prayers. Have you ever thought that God is testing you? He's testing you to see if you're going to be a strong Christian. I told him this morning, I'll tell y'all too, like in tomato plants. I know everybody getting ready to plant tomato plants, right? Y'all got some, they're probably about this tall. How in the world do you get a tomato plant this tall in April? Well, you got to put it in a greenhouse. whatever what you can get to grow. And then next thing you know, as you know is going to happen, because it happens every year, there's going to come another frost. Then what's going to happen? That big old tomato plant's going to go and just fall over dead. Why is that? Because it was a hothouse tomato plant. They ain't made to take the cold. That thing was raised up in the heat and never got exposed to the cold. And so when the cold hits it, boom, that's it, over and done. But you know, some people just sow a plant bed of tomato plants. And so that plant bed, as the plants are coming up, it gets cold on them. And it might burn a leaf or two off. It might make it wilt a little bit. Might even stunt its growth. But it comes back. And when it comes back stronger than ever. So when that final frost comes, that plant can stand it because it's already been put to the test. Do you know what I'm getting at? God puts us to the test. So when a big test comes, we'll already be strong from going through stuff. And so you never go through it alone. God's right with you. He puts us on the path that he puts us on. And we might grumble and we might gripe, but let me tell you, there's a rock that's guiding us. And what time, man, something's wrong with that clock over there, I'll tell you. There's something wrong with that thing. I'm going to get a new one that goes by my time. So I'm gonna just cut straight to the chase here. Let's just talk about this rock. This rock here, it says here, and behold, I will stand before thee there upon that rocky horn, and thou shalt smite that rock, and water shall come out of it. Well, I thought to myself, I just wonder what it was like to be that little rock there. You know, because I feel like a rock sometimes. And you know, rocks might talk, because the Bible says that if we don't praise God, the rocks will cry. You know, so I ain't going to let no rock out cry me. But let me, what would it be like to be that little rock? You know, that little rock has been depending on now. If you think we come from monkeys and the world is like millions of years old, then that rock's probably been there a long time. Like millions of years, but if you like me and believe, you know, what you find in the Bible, then you'd say that rock had probably been there about 5,000 years. But the whole time that little rock was there, he was by himself, and I bet it was prettier rocks all around him, and bigger rocks, and anybody that's ever done any stone masonry knows it's two kind of rocks. You got a rock that's got a face on it that you can use to lay in a wall, and then you got a coal, which don't have a face, and is basically good for nothing. So I can imagine if he struck that rock, it was probably a coal stone. So here's this little rock all by itself, never amounted to nothing, and all his life the other rocks had probably told him, you ain't going to amount to nothing, you ain't no good, and the little rock himself probably thought he didn't have a chance, he wasn't going nowhere, he was stuck going down a dead end road like me on that mountain road. I thought I was spinning on wheels, but we're never going to get to the end. But let me tell you, that little rock, you know that little rock was appointed by God. And I believe you are appointed by God. I believe I'm appointed by God. I believe we're all appointed by God for a purpose, just like that little rock. So I want you to do something that's going to sound crazy for Baptists. I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, you are appointed, neighbor. You are appointed. And I want you to shout it like you believe it. Say, you are appointed. Hey, because let me tell you, you are appointed by God. I believe God has appointed you unto greatness. And I feel good when I say that because I know it's true. And you know what that is? That's the Holy Ghost bearing witness with my spirit that it's so. God has appointed us to great things. And then let me tell you, just because God ain't used you yet don't mean that great things ain't coming your way. Let me tell you, God has appointed you to great things. He's appointed you with a plan and a purpose to fulfill. Hey, I know them big old pretty rocks was looking down on that little rock, but let me tell you something. When time come for God's plan to come out, the whole world knew that little rock had a purpose. And let me tell you, one of these days, when the time's right, the world's going to know your purpose. It's just right around the corner. Let me tell you, when your time comes, And let me tell you, it's not really your time, it's God's time for your life. It's so hard to wait though, ain't it? We want it to happen now. We don't want to wait for God. 5,000 years, that little rock had to sit there and endure the persecution and the suffering, when all of a sudden here comes Moses and he struck that rock and water came out, and that became one of the most famous rocks in the Bible. Let me tell you, it's because God appointed that rock for a time such as this. What did Ruth say? What did Ruth's uncle say to her? Said, for a time, excuse me, such as this, God has appointed you. And I'm telling you the same thing. For a time such as this, God has appointed you. But let me tell you something else. They said to Ruth, her uncle said, and if you don't do it, God will raise up somebody else. If you don't praise God, the rocks will cry out. If you don't stand true to God, He will appoint somebody else to do it. I'm telling you, you got to stand true, because not only are you appointed, not only was that rock appointed, but that rock was anointed. You know what I want you to do now, don't you? Don't you? Does anybody know what I want you to do now? I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, what? You are anointed. I want you to shout it like you believe it. You are anointed by God. I believe that with all my heart. Do you believe it? If you believe it, shout amen. Yeah, but let me tell you, if you ain't saved by the grace of God, then you don't believe that, do you? Because you can't receive it unless you've been saved by God's grace, unless you've been born again by the blood. If you've been born again by the blood of Jesus, then you know that you've been anointed with the Holy Ghost power. And let me tell you, the ones that God anoints are the ones God's going to use. Yes, He used that little rock. But let me tell you, in order for that little rock to be used, what had to happen to it? It had to be struck. Because you see, that stone, that little stone, that little rock is a symbol of Jesus Christ. Do you know that? Jesus Christ was just like that little rock. Jesus Christ was born, and in Isaiah it said he had no form of comeliness that we may be attracted to him, that we may be drawn to him. In the Bible, that's a real polite way of saying he's kind of ugly. He had no form of comeliness. That means he was pretty plain to look at. He didn't have nothing about him that would draw you to him. Like, you know, Joel Osteen, he's charismatic, and he can draw you to him. And all them other preachers, they got something I ain't got. I know I'm all right with it. It's okay. But they so charismatic, they draw you to him. But Jesus didn't have none of that. He was just a plain old country boy, old carpenter's son. He rode into town on a donkey. He wanted nothing special, nothing to look at, but God appointed him for that time. And then when God appointed him, God anointed him to carry out the mission he had. He was just a plain person. He was just a common person. But God used him to save the world. God loved him with a love that we can't understand, just like God loves you and me with a love we can't understand. Yes, Jesus is that rock. He's the rock of offense. And what happened to Jesus? After God anointed him, God smote him. He smited him. Ever how you want to say it? He hit him. He crushed him. For his iniquity, I'm saved. By his stripes, we are healed. He crushed him on the cross. He smote him for you and for me. Yes, sometimes God smites the ones that he loves. Sometimes God puts the ones that he loves through trials and tribulations in order that he may be glorified and that his kingdom may be advanced. So embrace your suffering. If it's for Jesus, if it's for God, and know that God is using every tear you've ever cried. God is using every hurt that you've ever felt. And hey, let me tell you, Jesus has felt it. What did it say in 1 Corinthians 10:13? There is no trial known to man that you face that's not common to any man, and especially the first man, Jesus Christ. He came to earth to be a man so he could feel our hurt, so he could feel our hurt and our pain, and so he could pour his life out for us. So let me tell you today, that rock is Jesus Christ. That rock, he is available today to give you a way of escape. Yes, when I drove down that road, I just kept looking toward that rock, and I finally made it out. Those Hebrew people, God put more on them than they could stand. They were thirsty to death. So God does put more on people than they can handle. God put more on them than they could take, and they were getting ready to die, but they trusted God, and he showed them a way out. That way out was Jesus. Let me tell you, if you trust God, he will always show you a way out, too. That way out is Jesus Christ. Yes, he hung on that cross and he died for us. And so I think if he died for us, we should live for him. That's the least we can do. And understand that not only are we appointed, but we're anointed. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for that rock. Lord, that spiritual rock that all of Israel drank from. Lord, that spiritual rock that we're still drinking from today. Drinking that living water that flows free from Jesus. Lord, it gets in us and it springs up and overflows us, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, Father. Thank you for Jesus. Lord, help us to walk in that appointing and to walk in that anointing, Lord. We just love you so much and we thank you for all that.